Welcome everyone to another episode of QB64 Report. I'm Felipe Heitor, and in today's episode we'll have a talk with Jared Hoffa, who wrote 486, a really cool game written in QB64 that is now available on Steam. So, on to our guest. Today we have here with us Jared Hoffa from Chicago, and his connection to QB64 is going to be an interesting one for you guys to hear. So, let's hear from the man. Hi, Jared.
Hey, how are you?
All good. So, tell us, how long have you been programming?
So, I actually started, and it's always been a passion of mine. It's never been a profession. I started when I was just a kid. I think I was maybe 8 years old, and I started on Apple Basic. And that was, I'll never forget, my dad worked overnight. He worked the third shift. So, he actually didn't work in programming either, but he, even as a kid himself, he was interested in computers. And I'll never forget the first time that he sat me in front of a computer and showed me how to do a step plus one program. Mm-hmm. So it made stairs. It was just a simple, blocks on the screen, and it made stairs. And then it blew my mind, even as a kid, to see, I was manipulating this computer. And that's how it started, and I just fell in love with it. And I stayed with it forever, on and off, on other projects I've done. And I just kept going. And even QBasic itself, and then obviously QBasic and now QBasic 64, that has always been kind of my core and always been the thing I've just absolutely loved.
So did you, after all, pursue a career in programming?
When I was in high school, I did have a small web design company I did. And the thing is, every job and every profession I've ever done, I've somehow, it always comes back to programming. I worked in TV at ABC ABC and NBC for over 10 years. I was on air on those. Oh. And even when I was on air, I was the app man or mom tech or, releasing the latest, gadgets that are coming out. Cool. And then even after I left TV, because right now I work for a law firm, I'm still designing and programming things for the law firm. It's just somehow it's always part of my life.
Yeah, I totally get it. Trying to introduce this hobby thing into your professional thing, I kind of get it.
Yeah, and maybe I look back on it a lot because a lot of my friends, even my family, ask, why didn't you just pursue that as a career? And I guess maybe it would have lost its fun had I gone ahead and made it a profession. That I'm able to do this as something. This is stuff I want to do. I'm not sitting, programming some login script for 40 hours a week.
I totally get it. The wife keeps telling me, are you going to make money with this someday? I'm like, I should lose the fun if I pursue it.
Right.
I totally get it.
It always comes down to the money.
Yeah.
No, for sure. I totally get that.
And now you're not officially a programmer. You have a day job, but we have 486.
That's right. 486. That it's a really interesting story how this came about. I could easily program in QBasic since I was a kid. And I had stopped programming for a while. I was sitting at work. I was at ABC at the time. And I was sitting in the edit room. And I, just for a whim one day, I was bored. I just kind of threw on the original QBasic onto the laptop I had. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I bet I can make a game right now. and my friend's like, yeah, right. Like, what are you doing? So I was like, yeah, I can do that. I'm going to prove it. And they're just like, what is this? Because you guys know that iconic blue background. It's so odd looking compared to what you'd think programming is, and the way it looks. And so I started firing off code, and I was like, I started really getting into it. This is just during work. And I was like, I could probably, I could make a game, I think, just something simple. My interest has always been trying to make games that use a lot of random integers, like RPGs, because even when I used to program dumb things in school, on a little TI-83, I like the idea of having this random integer, roll the dice sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So that's how I started. And then I very quickly obviously knew there was stuff I wanted to do. And I was looking up online how it'd be cool if I could get music, but it's really not that easy in QBasic. And it'd be awesome to have images and stuff. But I was like, it's really tough. And then that's when I stumbled upon QBasic 64.
When was that you had the idea for the game that you started showing off?
I think it was about, early 2016.
Oh, so you were already having to rely on DOSBox or something like that.
Yeah, I had just, I don't even know how. I just booted it up, and I was messing. Like I said, I was messing around, but I clearly knew there's limitations for like what I wanted to do, and I wasn't really at the point where I was going to sit and just try to design all these sprites and do this stuff. I just kind of want to see how far I could push it, and then that's when I looked online. I remember I was like googling and searching, you know, adding images to QBasic or adding MP3 to QBasic, and that's when I found QBasic 64. And it was just like this aha moment because I started reading the forums. I started reading how the compiler works, and I was like, "Oh man, like this is amazing! Like I could clearly do something with this," and I got really excited. So that's when I really said, "Okay, I'm gonna actually try this. I'm actually gonna try to finish a game." And that was 2016. Probably by April 2016, I started saying, "Okay, I'm gonna make a game." And that was the beginning of what eventually would become 486.
Well, 486 is pretty strictly an RPG in the sense that you go along places and you talk to characters. But you don't only talk to characters in your game.
Yeah. The game's very interesting. I wanted to have the basics of like a Dragon Warrior where you're kind of like running around and going to these shops and doing these things, but
hey, you totally need to go check out my Dragon Warrior clone, man. I actually just did one this year.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, and see, exactly. Yeah. So then you get it. So then, yeah.
Yep.
So I really loved that. That was kind of the first RPG that I played that I really liked the idea of an RPG. I was never really a big fan of them, and I didn't play that until, not when it came out, but way years and years later, but I was like, there's something cool about that. Like, traveling around, and the further you travel, the harder it gets, and you know, there's little stores, and you can do the stuff, and you know, the grinding of the fighting, you get better, and there's kind of there's a real reward to that. So I was like, man, I think I could do this. You know, I could do this in QBasic, but do it in a totally unique way. And that's when I first made the maps are all text-based, but then there's all this other animation and stuff that's happening that's images and you know, you're constantly, anyone who you run into, you're fighting. But then I added like a lot of just goofy things. Like, I wanted to really balance it out where there's no one way to play the game. There's no real way to win either. It's really, it's been referred to, and I now use this, it's been referred to as a retro-styled permadeath arcade RPG. So it's a bit odd in the sense that you're not trying to save a princess or fight a dragon. You're just trying to get the high score. And how you get the high score is entirely up to you. You can, you know, if you want to go sit at a bar in the game and drink the whole time, you can. You know, if you want to become an athlete and play like these little mini games or play DDR, you can. And that's what took so long to develop it, because I took one idea and I thought, okay, yeah, this will be easy to program. And then I just kept toying with it and adding things and making a game that I wanted to play, and it was an extreme challenge. But then, you know, finally, fast forward a couple years, and here we are. Now it's on Steam.
Yeah, and that's a very big thing. But before we go on to how you managed to get it into Steam, I mean, you're programming QBasic in the end, even though it's QB64. This is a feat. Still about the game and the gameplay. How long would it take someone to finish? Okay, you say there are many ways to play it, but if I want to take a long run of it until the end to make max score, how long would it take me to play it?
So we have, I basically say to anyone, it takes about 30 minutes to 45 to really start to feel like, okay, like I'm now winning, I'm getting cars, I'm getting weapons, my rep is high. So it takes about anywhere from 30 to 45 minutes to get to that level. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can also, even within 25 minutes, you start with 20. Within 25 minutes, you're starting to understand how the mechanics of the game work. Then it all depends on who has the high score. Now, the crazy thing is, the typical high score that I assumed would be 100,000, maybe 200,000. And if you look on the high score sheet, that's there. And that takes about 2 hours, probably, maybe more.
Nice.
But now there's people who have played that have 600,000, 700,000 high score. So they must have been playing for hours to get to that level. So it's really fascinating that it's gotten to that point. And I just checked today, and I'm already almost at 400 downloads of the game. And I just launched it 3 weeks ago.
And regarding the gameplay, you're mixing two very different and very specific styles of gaming here. You have a text-based mode, which is where you navigate, right? But then you enter bars and places to buy things and into fights, and there's this 3D animation. Please, guide us through.
Yeah, and this is where my game has been called odd in more than one occasion and on more than one review for this reason. Right, so on the surface level, the map itself is just really simple. It's tech. Literally, the houses are text-based, and it's really fundamental QBasic programming. I mean, even just QBasic itself, not even 64, because you could just text and a box moves. It's pretty easy to do. But I wanted to start to get the player into this experience and have kind of a, whoa, like, I'm in a store. So I actually have used Unity for modeling stuff before. So I didn't program anything in Unity, but what I did is I started modeling the inside of stores using Unity. And what I would do, which was insane, but for the simple stuff, it's I would just model a room and put a person there, and I would literally take a snapshot, and that would be the store. So when you go to CarMax and stuff, it's just you walk in, and there it is, and then you choose. So it's really just a static image. But then I started playing around with it, and I thought, man, I bet I could create animations this way. And it was absolutely insane. And I had, I mean, this is what took so long to release this game, because in some instances, when you're shopping for cars or any like a weapon, it's spinning 60 images a second. So I had to model the stuff, animate the stuff, record it as a video, then down convert it as PNGs or JPEGs. Mm-hmm. Then I had to bring it, I had to compress all those images and then tell QBasic, this is what I want to do. And this is when QBasic 64 really shined, because this is not possible with just traditional QBasic. This allowed me to basically, as you know, put an image in and immediately take it out as quick as possible. And for the longest time, I really struggled because I was just burning through memory and the game would just crash because I just, it was, I was pushing this so hard on doing this. And then there's music, there's MP3 music playing, and it was a lot going on, but it really gives the player a sense of some odd realism, you know, because they're robbing the store and it like shows them going behind the register or, you know, they're like drinking, they're taking the glass and drinking the whiskey at the bar.
Not counting the fights in the street.
Oh yeah, exactly. So then you have, you know, you have the fights in the street, which I did some really cool stuff with that too, because it's always a dice roll who you're going to run into, and it's a dice roll based on location. So just like in Dragon Warrior, the further away you go from home, the harder it gets. And so I actually indicate that on the map now, that, you know, if the further away you go, your chances of getting attacked by someone really hard is very high. But yeah, so then when the fights are happening, I'm constantly flipping through. So they're punching, and then I got to tell QBasic 64, okay, here's a hit, do this, and then redo it again. And I don't know, it was when I first did the first fight ever, when I animated it and they fell over, I was like, this is awesome. Like, there's something cool about just punching someone and they just fall. And it's like this, you know, insane game, and you're just like, wow. And I use a lot of, you know, I use sound effects for everything. So it almost does have that casino feel to it. Because it's like it constantly chimes and dings, and that you're like, you're winning, you're up, you level up, and it draws people in. It gets them feeling like, yeah, I'm progressing, I'm getting somewhere.
Totally, it touches people's minds when you make a ding sound in a certain way, and they want to hear it again, right? I gotta admit, I totally chickened out on the first fights in the preliminary versions you had sent me. Because some girls popped up and I was like, I'm not going to fight you. I can't run away. I ran away. And then that girl came again and I was like, okay, I'm going to have to fight you. And then, yeah, it was pretty satisfying to see them go down.
Yeah. Yeah. And I, you know, I made it a point that it's a variety of, it's men, women, it's all different types. And, you know, because I didn't want to make it seem like, what's this guy doing making a game where he just beat up women? And like, that wasn't the point. The game is really kind of a, in a sense, it's kind of a joke that, like, just everyone hates you. And I actually, that's almost based off of, like, jokingly, my friends, like, have always joked, like, everyone hates Jared Hoffa. It's like that joke where, like, everyone, I'm just that guy that people just hate for some reason. So we, like, I played off of that, like, this, because I originally was going to call the game, like, Jared or something to be a joke, because like everyone's always trying to kill me. So, but that's why I made it that way. So it was a tongue in cheek, type of ability. And then I really added to that. So there's like the mini bosses. And then also I realized too, like if you don't want to constantly fight people, that's when you do buy the cars, because then you can just fast travel around. So then, you know, because once you get to a certain point, you really start to have also just objectives. Like you could go fight robots to make money. You could go do DDR. And then if you want to avoid the fights, that's an easy way to do it. So there's a lot of mixing and matching in there, and a ton. There's a secret in there where I'm actually dressed as Red Foo from LMFAO, if you can find me. And you get $1,000 bonus.
That's
so
cool.
So there's, you know, I thought, I should have fun with this. You know, I'm not going to take this too serious. I want people to enjoy it, and if they find this, they're going to be like, what was that? You know, but that's kind of the point.
Yeah, definitely having fun while doing it is already payment, right?
Right. I mean, I always wanted to make a game that I would play, and I still play this game. And even my girlfriend, every once in a while, I'll just be on my computer and she'll be next to me and she'll just boot it up and start playing. So, I don't know, I take a lot of pride in the fact that I made something that I really love, and I'm just humbled and honored that, you know, almost 400 other people are now playing this game.
That's really awesome. The feeling is really awesome, right? Getting people that you've never personally met playing something you created is really something.
Oh, it's amazing. And I, like I said, I'm just so humbled. I know it's, you know, this isn't game of the year and it, you know, whatever, I'm not going to win awards, but just when I saw that first person and even the first review on Steam and they liked it, you know, that's, and after all these years, as you know, when you're really in the thick of something and it's like, so many times I was ready to give up because I just couldn't solve some of these advanced issues.
Mm-hmm.
And then pushing through it and then finishing it was just so remarkable.
Awesome. And now, well, you are on Steam and you're selling this game. And how did that come to be?
So I was in a few contests first to actually try to just get some feel and see how people would like it. And it helped a lot, actually. The game, I modified a lot of the game based on reviews. So I think even the first version that you played, I changed some things in that to help guide the player. Mm-hmm. And so I had it in some contests, and it would always do really well. I never like won anything or anything, but the reviews were always mostly positive, and people liked playing it. And then I thought, you know, my end goal was always to just get it on Steam. And honestly, I didn't think I was going to be able to. I didn't think compiling an EXE in QBASIC 64 was going to suffice Steam. Thought they'd be like, what the hell are you doing? Like, can't put this on here. But I looked into it. I looked into this, like, it's called Steamworks and the Steam dashboard. I looked at the requirements. I made a one-time payment, and then I compiled it. So it was actually a lot of work. I ended up hiring a friend of mine. His name's Tristan. He does the artwork, the cover art for the actual game itself.
Mm-hmm.
So, because, you know, once, it's the stuff I just didn't know because I never put a game on Steam. You know, there's a lot of requirements and specific artwork you need, certain layouts you need. The first time I did it, I was denied. You know, it didn't fit what they needed, and the review process took a while.
Oh.
So I figured out, like, the dimensions I needed, the formats I needed, I called my buddy, and he's a phenomenal artist. And I said, hey, can you, like, I really want to have, like, I want the artwork to really represent, like, the Atari artwork of the 70s and 80s. You know, can you do that? And he's like, yeah. So then he helped me with the artwork. I edited the video. And then it got approved on Steam. And then, I'm able to do a thing called Curator Connect. So I'm able to send copies out to people. And it's just been a wild ride. It's really cool being on this side of the screen where I'm the one delivering the content. I did also find out, though, I guess a few versions of the game, and this is, I guess, simply because, you know, it's QBASIC 64, but I actually had to put a digital signature because some of the first ones, Windows was flagging it as a questionable EXE.
Most antivirus software will not recognize it as a popular binary, something that a big company sent and lots of people are running and whitelisting it. So, yeah, we get that a lot.
Right.
So how did you get to the signing part?
Well, it didn't. It was already out. People were already buying it. So I don't know if they just were ignoring that and playing it. But I saw a message in, like, the 486 community on Steam. And the guy was like, what is this about? It's like, 10,000 extra. I'm like, oh, no. So I just looked it up. I looked up how to do a digital signature. I followed it. I compiled it off QBasic 64, attached this, ran these commands through Windows, and then uploaded and sent. And then no one seemed to have problems. He actually responded after that. I said, "Hey, I updated it," and he said, "Got it, thanks."
And
that's
something
actually really cool about Steam, and it's actually really cool about 46. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry. I was just going to ask about the signature. Was it something that you had to pay for it? Because I heard Microsoft has some certificate thing, and you have to be part of a program. Blah blah blah.
I mean, I didn't pay for it. I found like I'm saying Pro Tools, but it's not called Pro Tools. But I looked at their tools, their development kits, mm-hmm. and a lot of it. And I had to download two EXE files to do stuff. And then this guy explained, "Here's run this one, run this command, then take that file, run this, EXE, run it." And that was on the Microsoft website. And I just followed this guy's rules. I know there's easier ways, because the way I did it was like kind of convoluted and a little bit technical. Mm-hmm. And I've seen it too. I think there's much easier ways where you buy a signature and you just install it or something. But essence of time, I was just like, look, I can do this. I'm gonna do it right now, and I did it, and it did get approved. So the guy responded and said, "Thanks, it's working." So
awesome.
Yeah. So that was and that's what's cool actually about Steam. For anyone who is interested in getting their content on Steam, QBasic will work. Obviously, you'll need a signature, like I said. But it's kind of cool in the back end once you understand it, because when I would make tweaks or fixes, or like the first version I uploaded, I forgot to change something and kind of messed with the game. Mm-hmm. I just made the change, made the EXE file, and ran this command, and it like does this upload. And then everyone who has the game, it just automatically updates. So it's really nice in that sense, because when you have fixes and things, Steam is really really intuitive on getting that all figured out.
So Jared, 4086 is such an unusual product in the sense that it mixes styles, but it's so refreshing to play because it's fun. It's addictive in the way it's fun. What else are we expecting from 4086?
Well, no, I appreciate that, and that is what it's been called. It's odd. Everyone calls it odd addicting, which is true. So the next step for me really is, well, two things. One, I want to have as many people play this as possible. So I'm going to give you a bunch of Steam keys. If people are interested, you can figure out what's best to get them a copy.
Awesome.
If you're listening to this right now, you can also just buy the game on Steam. I always have it on sale. It's like 99 cents right now, but it usually goes to 50 cents. And then also dailyindiegame.com, they have the game listed for 50 cents. And then I'm part of their Summer Bundle 4, so you can get my game plus like 8 others for $1. So I'm trying to get as many people as possible to watch it. The next step, too, is I'm actually going to be building it into an arcade cabinet in Chicago. So I'm going to be using the same artwork the artist did, and we're going to use an old retro arcade cabinet, and we're going to install it at Replay Lincoln Park in Chicago. So if you're in Chicago or in Illinois or the Midwest, it will be there, hopefully in the next month. So when you see 46 with a keyboard on the arcade cabinet, you'll know it's mine.
This is really awesome. This is really awesome.
it'll certainly turn heads, that's for sure.
Well, Jared, thank you so much for being here with us. This was a pleasure hearing about a professional product being sold on Steam, and that's made on QB64, and it's fun. This is amazing. And everybody who's interested in trying a copy, so Jared is giving us a few copies. That's amazing. Just send us an email at contact@qb64.org and we'll be sending them out. They're limited, so be quick. Jared, thank you so much.
No, thank you, guys. I really appreciate it. And trust me, this won't be my last game on QBasic 64, so get ready for some more.
Awesome. Keep us posted. It's going to be amazing.
Will do.
This was the third episode of QB64 Report. I hope you guys enjoyed everything we brought to you today. And for our next upcoming episode, we're going to have an interview with Luke. Luke is going to be talking to us about TCP/IP communications with QB64. I wouldn't miss that if I were you guys. Thank you, everyone. See you next time. Bye-bye.